And the beat goes on, yeah, girl, don't go away, mierda, girl, just go away. Hajjad's L.A. Pro Bowl, missing it. I don't know why the Pro Bowl gets so much hate. Talk about that in a little bit. Missed the Senior Bowl because I was stuck at a JV wrestling tournament out in friggin' Anaheim. Brutal. JV kids just don't have the same commitment as the varsity athletes. JV kids are more content with sitting in the stands eating nachos and watching people and cheering them on. Just happy to be part of the team. Beautiful day once again out here in Southern California. Although it rained on the way in for about 15 seconds. It was the most rain we've seen in months. I was watching the news with my girlfriend and her little cousin the other day. And they're talking about the cold weather throughout the country. She's like, they're taking our winter. Oh, young lady, you do not know what you speak of. They can have the winter. I'll take the 80-degree days and the dry. And I'll take the drought. All we want. All right, right off the bat, we're going out to, speaking of cold weather, we're going out to Nashville, New Hampshire. We're going to go out and we're going to talk to Slush Redette. We're going to get his opinions on what happened with the Patriots and where the league is going. We got a few twit bag questions for him as well. So, yeah, well, hold on. I'm just getting a little technical glitch, if you will. But we're about to bring on Slush Redette. Slush, are you there? Slush, you there?
Coach, how you doing?
What's up, kid? How you been?
I'm pretty well.
Freezing your balls off and freaking Nashville, New Hampshire, I take it.
Yeah, pretty much.
You like that shit, though. You're a hibernator. You like sit in, watch freaking all types of Netflix movies and shit.
Yeah, it just kind of validates my laziness.
Speaking of Netflix movie, before we get into football, I got freaking a ruse pulled over me. I went and watched Silver Linings Playbook last night. Have you seen it?
I've never seen it, no.
Don't. Somebody need to give me a warning. I thought it was going to be about this crazy guy who was an Eagles fan and watching football and shit. It turns into freaking Dirty Dancing about halfway through. It's brutal, kid.
Yeah.
It's fucking bait and
I heard there was a ballroom dancing angle. That kind of turned me off.
It's a bait and switch. It's brutal. You know, it got playbook in the title. I see the guy wearing a Deshaun Jackson jersey, Bradley Cooper, Robert De Niro. I'm all in. Freaking.
Yeah, the soundtrack's magical, too, but I'm not going to bite on it.
Let's talk Patriots. Give me a synopsis. I'll give you some time. Go. What do you think? How do they improve, first off?
I think the improvement is you got to make up for all those offensive weapons you lost, you know? I mean, you can't just turn over that kind of – the defense, even with all the injuries, I thought still did pretty well. If you're telling me you're holding Denver to 26 points, you're not going to be happy about that. I'm certainly going to be happy about it. So I think they just got to fill in some offensive weapons. You know, I think they got to go after they you know, you don't know what you're going to get from Gronk. I think they need some other type of tight end. They need someone that can exploit the middle of the field, maybe a wide receiver on the outside of the field. And, you know, I mean, they need that. I mean, so I don't think they're too far away. There's a few missing parts that they really need. I mean, I think this is probably one of the weaker teams we fielded in a while, and it was good enough to get us that far. So I think there's just a few things you need to plug in and kind of make the most out of Brady's time that he has left. I think it's kind of encouraging they made it this far with that team.
I don't think so. I disagree. I disagree wholeheartedly, and I'll give you a couple of reasons why. One, Patriots lost the game up front, and we've continued to watch this team for the last 5 to 6 years having a mediocre pass rush, to steal a phrase from Richard Sherman, a mediocre pass rush, average players on the back end. I mean, Talib, you know, yeah, I guess, you know, one time it's bad luck, two times, three times it's a fucking trend, you know, and again, Talib is just not the guy. He's always something with them. You know what I mean? And how often are we going to sit here and watch the Patriots avoid getting premier pass rushes and avoid getting playmakers on the back end that can be there when it matters? And, oh, man, it's just amazing the Patriots got zero pass rush in that game. None.
No, look, I agree with you. I mean, it's a need, but I mean, you had them at this is the best deep offense in the history of the league, right? And you held them to 13 points in the first half.
Well, part of that was just the long sustained drives. The Patriots only had the ball, I think, 8 times. And it was just a long, sustained drive. They couldn't get off the field. Denver just bled them to death. And what happens is people look at the game and look at, from all the bullshit I've read over the years about, you know, advanced stats and all that shit, but one thing I've taken away from it, the first drive is just as important as the last drive. And on the first drive, and you're 3rd and 3, and you're throwing a fade route to Matthew Slater, I can count on one hand how many times Matthew Slater's been targeted in the last... what, 4 years, 5 years? And then you're throwing the ball to Austin Colley, a guy they cut. Is, you know, they cut him 4 times this year. And this is what they expect to go in and win the Super Bowl or go to the Super Bowl with just...
Yeah, I agree. Those are spots they need real talent. I mean, what does that tell you about Amendola, too? Austin Colley usurps you in the championship game? I mean, where is this fucking guy?
Well, in Vereen, Blount... I knew they weren't going to be able to ride that train all the way through. It was a nice little, you know, he did what they needed him to do, but Blount was, you know, they were going to catch up to it. But it's amazing. I can't stand Josh McDaniels, as you well know. It's amazing to me that Josh McDaniels has a job, and people just think that he's doing a good job because he's not.
Yeah, Indy's defense, we turned out, was tissue paper, and week 16, Buffalo didn't exactly feel like tackling anymore.
Yeah.
So I agree. It wasn't like they were going to be able to run. But that's the thing. If they can't do that run, I mean, that was just masking problems. Who is it really that he's going to throw the ball to? You know, who is it really he's going to move the sticks?
Yeah.
There's not much there.
And I'm tired of hearing, especially coming out of the Northeast Corridor, I'm hearing that, you know, Brady just hasn't played well in big games. He missed 2 throws. He missed that play action, which was not really an easy throw. He threw it back across the field, missed Edelman. On that would have been huge. I think it was the second series of the game. And then he missed that one there at halftime where Austin Colley kind of put a hand up. But other than that, Tom was spot on. And they freaking 2 huge drives ended in sacks when guys just got beat. Beat clean inside. The future, you know, I'm not as optimistic about the future as you are. I think they're flawed. And I'll say it, I think they're flawed coaching-wise. Belichick's supposed to be this defensive freaking guru. The defense has been average at best since what?
Well, it started like it was going to be a lot better. I mean, I know we weren't exactly playing offensive juggernauts, but when everyone was healthy in there, it was playing like a fairly top D, you know, at least top half D, which I think was the whole plan. We don't need to be top ranked, you know, but we were, at least when everyone was there, we were playing, you know, above board. But like you said, Tlaib seems like he's another one made out of fucking paper mache here.
And I hope they don't sign him.
I don't know if it comes back after an injury like that the same. You know, Mayo's one of those guys, you don't really give him all that much credit until you realize how much you miss him when he's gone.
I think the linebacker position was solid all the way through, and I hope that this Brandon Spikes thing wasn't about him not being able to make it through a freaking blizzard. Kid, you know how hot it is to drive around there and freaking when the weather's, you know, especially a guy from Florida. You don't freaking know.
No, I don't fucking know. I'm at my fucking employer's point of business every day on fucking time. So I don't know what his problem is. I fucking make it to where I gotta go, dude.
Please,
bullshit. They probably have car service. I'm not giving him a pass on that. And that's my favorite defensive Patriot, too.
I know, and they're going to let him go. Seems like they're going to let him walk as well.
Yeah, I agree. Jamie Collins is probably the mold anyways.
Yeah.
You know, he would have been an awesome linebacker to have in 1987, but now you need a guy that can drop deep in coverage.
Who, Spikes, you mean?
Yes.
Oh, Spike's a great linebacker. I think you'll miss him.
I love the attitude that he brings to the team, and I think he kind of sets the tempo. But let's face it, I mean, it got to the point where he'd come off the field every 3rd down. You know, I mean, I think you need a guy that can cover.
I think Collins is a freak athlete. I think he's where the league is going, where you take the guys who are secondary-type players with just tremendous athletes and put them at the linebacker level. When they brought that guy, man, he brought it. You know what I mean? And it just seems like they didn't bring him at all. It seemed like they couldn't get to Peyton. And I don't know. I think that's why. I'll save my predictions later. I'll throw it at you. Who wins the Super Bowl?
I think it's pretty hard to handicap because I think Seattle's got serious problems scoring points. I don't think they come that easy for them. So I think I just naturally am geared towards offense. Everything's rigged towards the offense. So if you'd have a team that scores points, I take them. But since it's being played in a fucking frozen tundra and Manning doesn't come out of the turtle shell for that all the time, and they do have the rush and everything, I think it's Seattle on a squeaker.
I do too. I think when push comes to shove, are you watching the Pro Bowl right now? I'm recording it. I watched a little bit of it.
No, I'm not.
Are you one of the Pro Bowl haters?
Yes, I am.
How?
Yeah.
Why?
Because I'd rather watch a fucking little kid's soccer practice. There's just as much contact and just as much action.
Oh, I disagree. I watched the first quarter and a half before I left, and they were getting after it this year. I think Dion and Jerry Rice put a fire under their ass.
Oh, God, no. When I even heard that that's what they were going with, I couldn't even stomach it. No, I skip it every year.
Kid, what is the deal with Deion Sanders' beard? He looks like Grady from freaking Sanford and Son with his freaking white beard. I would think he would have some kind of stylist. It's like, you know, I look at guys like that, and they just make me feel old. You know, prime time with a white beard? What the fuck? You know?
True story.
I like the Pro Bowl. You know, I like seeing athletes play. You know, it used to be better back in the day when you weren't so inundated with football and it was a chance to see some guys that you never really saw play. But now you see them all play. But still, it's freaking football, kid. I'll watch that shit over World Cup action any day, twice on Sunday.
It's just the meaningless of it. I don't know. It loses it for me.
I got a question for you, and I'm pulling it out of the twit bag, and I'm pulling it out early. And I want to get your opinion on this. If the NFL gave you carte blanche to change any of the rules in the NFL, what would they be?
Well, I guess I would. If I don't know in terms of a rule, I would eliminate or create, but I would certainly want to change the enforcement of the pass interference rules.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, they've become so subjective, and they're such the key moments, and it just seems like they're so ticky-tack now that the defensive players are at such a disadvantage. So I don't know what the easier way to combat that is. Maybe if you let them have a little more contact up front or what, I don't know. But I certainly don't want to fix a rule by adding a new rule saying that the wide receiver has to make an attempt to catch the ball or something. But I just think that it's so rigged towards the offense that you have to let defenders play a little bit more. Either that or they're allowed to hit quarterbacks more freely. Something on that end, something that tilts the scale a little more in a just manner for the defense.
I'll give you my five, and I'll let you retort. Here are my five that I really want to see happen in the next few years. One, I think they should make pass interference reviewable. I think any of these huge 40-yard pass interference penalties, I think they should be challengeable. Second one I really don't like is the intentional grounding outside the quote-unquote tackle box, okay? Because the tackle box can be changed, especially if you went unbalanced formations, okay? Or if you split your line out. I cannot stand the intentional grounding rule. It's too ambiguous. The biggest one that really freaking raises my rent, I'll tell you right now, is when a defensive player jumps and an offensive player fakes like he jumped and starts pointing at the defensive player and it goes against the defense. Yeah, that one really freaking raises my rent. And the last one that really gets me, this is only four I know I can count, is I think holding should be 5 yards the first time offensive lineman or anyone creates a holding penalty. I think it should be 5 yards. I think it should be 10 yards the next time. And then I think it should be 15 yards the third time. Because they cripple drives on these arbitrary holding calls that you could call holding on every play. I know it's a Chris Collinsworth, you know, tried and true statement, but it's true. And they just decide to call holding on certain times. If it's a blatant egregious hold, I think they should go 10 yards. They can go 10 yards. But some of it, there should be a discrepancy between 5-yard holding and 10-yard holding, similar to roughing the punter, which they fucked up in the last game. Agree? Disagree? Did I throw too much at you, freaking slow head?
My only question is the one about the intentional grounding. You're saying more of those should be intentional grounding,
yes,
correct?
And yeah.
I call that such?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, then I completely agree with you there, and I think you should fire off an email to Goodell. On the holding one, I think you need a strong deterrent because, like I said, everything's rigged for the offense anyways. So I think you need a pretty strong deterrent to stop them from doing that. Because, yeah, you can and do hold on every play. So why even want to make it more likely? I don't really completely agree on that one.
It kills drives, though.
The pass interference review, well, I guess if it's a challenge, I'm all for it. But, man, these games are getting into, like, MLB territory. You know, we cannot grind them to a slower pace than they already do.
Yeah, but they're doing that on purpose. There's so much shit they could take out of it that, you know what I mean? It's a constructed thing because they want the ad revenue. You don't need to, you know, kick off, go to commercial. You know, you've been to plenty of pro games. How much do you sit around and they all stand on the field and shit? They could change that.
Yeah, I agree. If they can just message down whether it's something they confirmed touchdown or not a touchdown in the end zone, why can't they just shoot it down that it's either a fumble or not a fumble or something else? I don't know why someone has to go and run and jog, you know, over to a booth and then jog and then spot the ball. It seems like there should be an office where a bunch of team of people are doing that and just shoot it down by radio.
Oh, yeah, amongst other things, but really, you know, these 40-yard penalties and 50-yard penalties, they got to go. They got to find a way to get rid of it. Those things change games. People only remember the last 2-3 minutes of games. But like I said before, every fucking drive counts. Every possession counts. So, go ahead.
Yeah, maybe they should go like more like college and just make it a 15-yard penalty then.
The only thing with that is I could be talked into that, too, if we had more time to talk about that. The only thing with that is you can really just tackle guys if they're freaking gone. But, yeah, I mean, I would have my problem. I think it's just egregious, you know, because the pass interference and the holding are so subjective because they fucking happen every play, you know, and then all of a sudden they're going to decide to call it. And well, shit, my sixth one would be the pick routes. Make up your mind with that shit. You know, we can talk about that forever. What do you think about Belichick calling out Welker like that?
I just think he went too far with it. He showed he was just so sensitive about Welker in the moment because, yeah, absolutely, 100%, that was fucking intentional. He was not trying to get open. I don't think he was trying to hurt him. I think he's trying to take him out of that play, though. But the thing is, you know, it was totally intentional, and it was at full speed. A lot of those picks are not happening at that speed. So I don't think that's one of these happens on every play type situation. But Belichick saying it was the worst thing he's ever seen, I thought that might have been a little bit of an overreach.
Petty. And I think Belichick's petty, you know. It's well documented on these airwaves that I do not drink the Kool-Aid of the Bill Belichick, you know, philosophy everyone has. At least have a fucking play sheet in front of you. You know, you want to call a play to win. I've been watching on the NFL Network, these old Super Bowls are showing, and at least Bill Cowher, even a guy I don't have, you know, the greatest respect for, at least he had a play sheet, and they're showing him talking, and he's like, hey, let's run this. I don't think Belichick does that. I really don't. I don't think he calls offensive plays at all, and I think he saddled us with the mediocre, and I say us, like I freaking play for the team, but I think he saddled the Patriots with the mediocre defense, and he's just been living high off the hog off one of the greatest quarterbacks, if not the greatest quarterback of all time.
Well, I think Belichick, the GM, I don't think many people are drinking the Kool-Aid on that around here. I mean, I think the personnel, people question, you know, when you start stockpiling record guys and all that shit, people start to wonder, where are our studs? But Belichick, the coach, I think you're lucky to have him. Fuck that. I mean, I see all sorts of guys that just blow my mind. I mean, Chip Kelly, you love his offense. Dude, I watched that guy piss down his leg every fourth quarter. He personally cost them 2 games, but he's a fucking moron.
You're talking about a rookie head coach. You want to go back and watch the films on Billy Belichick with the Browns in the mid-90s? You know, you're talking about first-year head coach. It's stability. The reason the Patriots have done well is stability. And even though Bobby Kraft's running around with his friggin' girlfriend half his age, who's going to be owning the team, even though you defended he's the right to relationship any way he wants. Bullshit. When she's running the friggin' franchise, kid, and then she moves the franchise to Providence, Rhode Island, you'll be the first one crying about friggin' the days of Myra Kraft. You know, I can guarantee you that much.
That's neither here nor there.
Yeah, you're neither here nor there. Hey, thanks for stinking up my airwaves. I appreciate it. I can smell your breath coming through the rigging microphone. Good talking to you, Slush. Hope all is well. Thanks for your patronage.
All right.
And I'll hit you up in the next few weeks.
You're welcome, America. Take care, Coach.
You're the man. Later. All right, now that we can clear up that ringing garbage spewing from Nashua, New Hampshire, let's get into the notes this week, whatever we got. Big stuff coming around this week. First and foremost, Notre Dame joining up a partnership with Under Armour. 10-year deal worth $90 million to get the Golden Domers back in relevancy. I pray might be a strong word, that Notre Dame will not go to the uniform of the week, a la Maryland, a la Oregon and Oregon State. I hope Notre Dame sticks with the traditionals, but I have a bad feeling they're not gonna. I think they're gonna stick all types of leprechauns and shamrocks, which I like. Hey, look, I gotta bring in hidden shamrock tattoo somewhere. But I just hope Notre Dame sticks with their traditional colors and color scheme for the rest of the time. But 10 years, $90 million. And the NCAA claims that they're unsuable because they're an educational program with the colleges. Ugh. Alabama. How about Alabama? How about Nick Saban's daughter? Man, she got no fight with a girl at Alabama. First of all, she goes Alabama. Nick, you would think common sense-wise, you wouldn't want it as a student at Alabama. It's just too much there. You know, I mean, there's a big bullseye on her chest, you know, proverbially. You know, someone's going to try to do something to her. She's going out with the tight end of the football team. Just talk about an awkward situation. Nick, couldn't you send her to some liberal arts college somewhere in New England? Send her to Colby College. Send her to Williams. Send her to Alabama. But evidently, Nick Saban's daughter beat the hell out of one of her sorority sisters because she was claiming that Nick Saban's daughter was claiming that her sorority sister was, nobody liked her on Facebook, so she confronted her, and Nick Saban's daughter knocked her freaking cold. Nick Saban's being sued, and so isn't the daughter. Just think it's too much. Why would he even bother with that? Moving on in the college ranks, what else do we have? Well, ESPNU is going to 11 hours signing day coverage. They're going to have reporters at over 15 schools on signing day, which is February 5th, which would be here before you know. And you know, if you follow that stuff, do you know how many decommits happen between the All-Star Games and February 5th? Do they sign binding contracts? I have a kid in my school verbally committed to Arizona State, and now he's pulling the offer. It's just become a joke. But you got 15 reporters at the schools throughout the country reporting on this stuff. Talk about building kids up. Talk about building, you know, making these kids more feel more important than they are. Speaking of which, segue, Justin Bieber, how does he relate to football? Keyshawn Johnson and Eric Dickerson both came out this week saying about damn time that Justin Bieber got pulled over for drunk driving. Evidently, Eric Dickerson and Keyshawn Johnson live in the neighborhood, and they see it all the time. And Bieber's running around, he's going like 70 miles an hour and 25 mile per hour districts and stuff like that. And then there's people out in the Twitter sphere and out in public saying, oh, you got to catch Justin Bieber some slack because he's 19. Forget that. We're going to cut that kid slack because he's 19. We were all 19 at one point. Granted, we made mistakes, but we weren't going 100 miles an hour flying around drunk. Well, I kind of take that back. There was an incident one time when I was 19. I was taking my mother's Chevy Celebrity and we were drag racing back roads, but nobody got hurt. And I wasn't an international star. I didn't have, not yet anyway, but I didn't have all types of paparazzi follow me. But forget that. But Keyshawn and Eric Dickerson, neighbors with Justin Bieber. I don't understand. If I was Justin Bieber, I would go live somewhere by myself in some kind of palatial homestead where nobody was around. I wouldn't even have neighbors if I was any of those guys, to be honest with you. I don't know why they continue to do so. Let's jump into the pro game. Special ed teacher. And this time of year, you always get these stories about jersey selling and fandom. The fandoms come out of the woodwork. People, the bandwagon bowl, Seattle, Denver. I swear, there's more people from the Pacific Northwest and Denver in these next week and a half than I've ever seen in my life. But special ed teacher buys jerseys for all the kids in the whole school. Over 500 kids they bought Seahawks jerseys for at about $50 a piece. Good idea. You couldn't buy anything better than Seahawks jerseys for all the kids. And speaking of this, every year we come to this point, there's always the story of the guy in the enemy territory who wears a uniform or wears a jersey that he's not supposed to wear. And again, we get it this year with the kid who was in Tacoma, Washington, teenager was working at Nathan Wentz. Was working at Odyssey One, which is a family entertainment shirt. They said, hey, you can wear jerseys as long as they're Seahawk jerseys. So what does young Nathan do? He wears his Bronco jersey. He's always that kid growing up. And it was always the contrarian. You know, growing up when I was, you know, in Massachusetts, it was the Red Sox fan, the kid who would always wear the Yankee gear. You know, and nobody likes those kids. They're always pompous. They're always a little bit too smart for their own good. And this kid comes in, walking in with his Broncos. So he's been a Broncos fan since he was three. Never been to Denver in his life. Just picks it out of the blue. Wants to be contrarian. Sent home for wearing it. Fired. And now he's just, you know, now I'm saying his name over the airwaves. It's always, every year they got that story of that kid who decides he wants to wear the jersey. Whatever happened to local pride, right? We wouldn't you should root for the teams that you live in the area for. Unless there's some kind of extemporaneous circumstances. Speaking of extemporaneous circumstances, how about the Raiderettes? This is an interesting one because this can divulge into a political argument. The Raiderettes, the Raider cheerleaders, check this out. They're making a one-time stipend of $1,200 a year for being cheerleaders, for professional cheerleaders for the Raiders. They're making $1,200 a year. It comes up to like $3 and something cents an hour. And they're suing the team for lost wages because also they have to pay. There's very strict standards. They have to have their hair a certain way. They have to have their makeup a certain way. They have to pay for their own traveling. It's amazing. They get $1,200 a year. This is capitalism gone astray. All right. And I'm going to go on a little political rant here for a minute because you know why? Because there's always those people, those free market people, free marketeers who will say, oh, if they don't want to do it, they get someone else. Sure. They could get some other cheerleader and exploit them as well. But you got a billion-dollar franchise like the Raiders paying these cheerleaders who bust their ass in more ways than one. They make $1,200 a year and nobody says a damn thing about it. You know, the NFL and Eric Goodall, they think this is fine, that these girls, if they don't want to do it, they won't do it. Forget all that. There should be some kind of baseline wage that these poor girls get paid. Because those girls work hard. I tell you what, the cheerleaders in my school work just as hard as the football players. It is a sport nowadays. I'm telling you, there's serious year-round commitment that cheerleaders put in. And to pay them $1,200 a year is a freaking disgrace. And it's amazing that they let them get away with it, but nobody says a damn word about it. Hopefully they win. And I like the Raiders, and I hope, you know, but hopefully they win. And hopefully some kind of standard and some kind of livable wage can be developed from these girls. I'm not saying they have to be full time, but shit, they should at least be paid, compensated for the time and their efforts. They shouldn't have to pay for their own hairdressers and things of the like. Mike Pettine, new coach of the Browns, his daughter came out this week and tweeted, oh, my dad's a new NFL coach. It's the Browns, though, but that's okay. You know, just the day and age of having teenage daughters and trying to keep them off the Twitter sphere. That'd be very difficult. How do you keep that away from your daughter if you become a head coach? And you're going to see this stuff more and more, become more and more likely, I guess, is the word I'm looking for, through the years. Poor guy. But I give a lot of credit for Mike Pettine. I think it's actually a decent hire, even though first of all, he's a high school coach. He came from the high school ranks, which I appreciated. But I don't know if anybody watched that documentary in 99, when Mike Pettine was the head coach of his high school team. Just a vicious bastard to these high school kids. Just degraded them all over the board. It was uncomfortable. I remember watching him as a young man, just getting to coaching myself. And I was watching, this guy is breaking a jack off. Just ripping high school kids. So we'll see what happens. The Browns. All the mock drafts. I'm surprised. I'm shocked how many mock draft experts there are in the Twitter sphere. How many people dedicate their lives in the Twitter sphere to ranking kids at the Senior Bowl. which I didn't watch, which I wanted to watch, but I didn't. You know, all these people ranking kids, but anyways, I'm going on a tangent. They all got Johnny Manziel going to Cleveland. You got Johnny Manziel going to Cleveland. You never know. Now all of a sudden, Cleveland can turn it around, and Mike Pettine is going to have the proverbial genius title thrown onto him. You know they're talking about hiring Cam Cameron to the Cleveland Browns. But Cam Cameron, you know, even though he got fired, how quickly we forget, he got fired from the Ravens last year, and the Ravens go on and win the Super Bowl. Cam Cameron this year, though, was the offensive coordinator at LSU. He's the first team in SEC history. I was reading this. First team in SEC history under Cam Cameron and Les Miles to have a 3,000-yard passer, 1,000-yard rusher, and 2,000-yard receivers on the same team. First team in SEC history. Cameron is like 60-something-year-old retread. Supposedly, he's going to the Cleveland Browns to be the next offensive coordinator. Speaking of retreads, how about Joe Lombardi, Vince Lombardi's great-grandson? Oh, no, his grandson, rather. Is now going to be the offensive coordinator for the Lions. Oh, talk about nepotism. Talk about having inside track on the job. You know, talk about something that gets the foot in the door. Don't even tell me, oh, he earned it. Yeah. His last name was Lombardi, as in bringing Vince Lombardi. So now he's going to be the next offensive coordinator for the Lions and watch the Lions go to mediocrity. Who knows? Still might be all right. Moving on, the pro game. Josh Brent, defensive lineman for the Dallas Cowboys, convicted of intoxication manslaughter Wednesday. Ended up killing his teammate in a manslaughter, in a drunken accident, killed his best friend, Jerry Brown. But he only ended up with 180 days in jail. You know, to me, that's, I don't know. I mean, I understand people make mistakes, but 180 days in jail for causing that type of destruction. They said he had 17 drinks. And of course, in that he was twice the legal limit and he was speeding. Ended up killing his best friend. Nothing funny about that, just something worth, wow, wrap your head around. Something I thought was a little funny, though. Brandon Jacobs, former running back for the Giants and the 49ers, calls out Jim Harbaugh this week. Quote, he's a bitch and that's why they never win anything. Good for Brandon Jacobs. Like when guys retire and just let it all go. They say whatever they want. Speaking of letting it all go, how about Richard Sherman? I talked about it last week, of course, but, you know, you're just going to get inundated with Richard Sherman stuff for the next week until the game's played. It's a tough thing with Richard Sherman. It's like I talked about, the guy, they caught the guy in the heat of the moment. If anybody's ever, you know, played football, especially at that level, you're a manic state at that point. The guy's obviously going to be running his mouth. So, you know, have Aaron Andrews stick a microphone in the guy's face and be like, he's talking about you. Of course the guy's going to run his mouth. But it's amazing the Twitter sphere, the racism that's been thrown out. But Richard Sherman gets paid, and I talked about it a little bit last week, $600,000 a year. How does a guy who is arguably the most famous player in the NFL right now, other than maybe Peyton Manning, Tom Brady, usuals, get paid $600,000 a year? You know, I equate that with the rate of cheerleaders getting paid $1,200 a year. In a sport that is by far and away the most popular sport in the nation. Matter of fact, they just came out with a stat this week. They polled, I don't know who they polled, but the Harris poll, these are professional poll people, said 35% of the country says the NFL is their favorite sport compared to second place, which is Major League Baseball at 14%. Well, even this PE teacher can do the math, and it's twice as more popular. The NFL is twice as more popular than Major League Baseball. Thought this was interesting moving forward, though. Third place of most popular sports is college football at 11%. Fourth is auto racing at 7%. Fifth is the NBA at 6%. Sixth is the NHL at 5%. Seventh is NCAA hoop. So don't tell me, you know, soccer is the most popular sport. Maybe, all right, it's the most popular sport in the world, but I'd rather watch grass grow. I digress. My show, I can have that opinion. Although, a perfect example today, I stopped at the AMPM when I came into the place, and I don't know, I guess I'm wearing soccer-type gear, and the lady's like, oh, you a soccer fan? No, not at all. She's like, oh, I love soccer. I just don't like American soccer. I don't even know what American soccer is. evidently, according to her, it's, you know, MLS, like LA Galaxy. But to me, you like the sport, you like the sport. Same thing with the Pro Bowl. It's amazing to me how many people come out and say, oh, Pro Bowl is terrible. I can't watch Pro Bowl. But they're supposedly fans of the sports, of the sport. How does that even work? How do you say, oh, I love the sport, but I don't like the Pro Bowl? It's an all-star game. There's going to be some concessions there. I actually like the little tweaks they did this year, kind of mixing up the rosters and all that. You know, at least it adds a little bit of spice to it. I think they should make the teams, and I've been around football my whole life as a coach and a player. I think they should make the losing team run more at the end. I think if a team loses, they should have to do like 2,000-yard sprints at the end, and the other team gets to catcall them and talk trash to them the whole time while they're running. Talk about incentive. Nobody wants to run. No football player wants to run. I'm telling you, people will bend themselves backwards to avoid extra running. It happens all the time. Just got a chance to watch a little bit of the Pro Bowl. Watch Jimmy Graham try to, something about Jimmy Graham that rubs me raw. I just think he's a big body. I think you get big bodies in the NFL and throw the ball up to him to make plays. But the one thing I am on Jimmy Graham's side is New Orleans is trying to, America's feel-good team from a few years ago, they're trying to stick the franchise tag on him. In which I'm not an expert on the franchise tag. I know a little bit about it. And with the franchise tag, though, evidently they pay the average salary of the they take like the highest paid player in that position, quote unquote, and they pay you a percentage of whatever that highest paid player gets. And I know I'm kind of butchering that, but that's the general gist of it. Jimmy Graham, they're trying to stick him as a tight end, even though he had less than a third of the snaps this year. We're at the tight end position. They're trying to stick him with the tight end money, even though he's clearly a receiver. And receivers, on average, make $4 million a year more than tight ends. But they're trying to stick him. They're trying to lock him down and make him play for the Saints next year because they're just going to call him a tight end. It's all semantics. Even though he doesn't line up as a tight end, they're going to pay him $4 million a year less. Amazing. Getting back to the same theme of Ergodal. And the Gestapo-like tactics that are the NFL. Let it go free market. You know, and again, I'm not a free marketeer, but let them pay players for their value. Don't hold these guys hostage for these arbitrary things. You know, a guy like Richard Sherman making $600,000 a year, which in those terms aren't that much. You got middle-of-the-road baseball players. Basketball players. You got Chris Humphreys, backup center for the Celtics, makes $12 million a year. The only thing anybody knows that guy because he's married to one of the Kardashians. But you take that money that Richard Sherman's not making, you know who's making the money? The owner. Paul Allen's making the money, not Richard Sherman. The scam. Oh, the whole thing is... I digress. Speaking of money, let me take a drink first. Speaking of money, Vince Young, who had a $25 million guaranteed contract signed 8 years ago. I don't know who he got that contract. I'll tell you how we got it before this collective bargaining agreement that they had a few years ago. Anyway, Vince Young is now $10 million in debt and now has filed for bankruptcy. 30 years old. There's a guy who kind of got robbed of the system of the way the things are in the NFL. There's a guy with talent that could play well, but just never got in the right system. Never going to hear from poor Vince again in bankruptcy for the rest of his damn life. Moving on, Super Bowl, Mike Adams, safety for the Denver Broncos, claims that the Broncos win the Super Bowl, he's going to walk home from the Meadowlands of New Jersey to Paterson, New Jersey. It's over 15 miles. He's going to walk home in the rain and snow. Oh, I hope they put a camera on him and follow him the whole way. That'd be great television to watch this guy walk through the streets of New Jersey all the way back home with the camera on him. I kind of hope the Broncos win for that fact alone. What else do we got? Saban, Josh Brand, all that. Well, it just seems like it's all economics. NFL minimum, rookie wage scale is $480,000. You may say, oh, you know, I would do anything for $480,000 a year. I mean, that's a terrible. The average lifespan in the NFL is about a year and a half, something like that. $480,000 not enough when the fat cats are making the money. I'm beating a dead horse. Let's go on to something a little bit more. What else? How about, well, we talked about it earlier a little bit with Slush. with the egregious play, quote unquote, that Wes Welker made. Seattle cornerback Walter Thurman says he got away with it because of his status. Said, well, Wes Welker is one of the golden boys. Anybody else done that, they would have been suspended or fined. In the Legion of Boom in Seattle, Walter Thurman, I agree. Same type. I still don't think Wes Welker really did it on purpose, though. Talked about that earlier. Another rule change. You know, I talked about rule changes earlier. Another rule change has been big this week is talking about getting rid of extra points in the NFL, which I think is an egregious mistake. How could you even think about dropping the extra point in the NFL? Why are you going to take the kicking game? And last year at this time, they were talking about just taking away the kickoffs. I have a hard enough time trying to defend to my British friends at the bar I go to, which I live right down the street. I hang out with a bunch of Brits. Like, why is it called football anyways? They don't use their feet. Well, why are you going to try to take away? Of course they use their feet. The kicking game is a huge part of football. But why you got to try to take away the kicking game by getting rid of the extra points? That's not even possible. I won my first game as a head coach 7-6 because we blocked their extra point. Granted, it's high school. It's a little different. But how are you going to penalize guys because they become great at their job, become efficient at their job? You're just going to give points like a gimme? How are you going to tell that to Tony Romo when he botched a 19-yard field goal 2006, left the Cowboys out of the playoffs and started beginning the downfall that was the Romo, is the Romo era, even though I kind of like Tony Romo. I think he's a good quarterback. Or 2010, week 14, the Redskins botched one. Or 2006, kept the Bengals out of the playoffs as well. Botched a field goal. If Roger Goodell thinks it's that easy, I think they should have Roger Goodell go out there and try to hold an extra point. They should add something like that into the Pro Bowl. Have Roger Goodell come out there and put a little helmet on him and have him hold an extra point. That'd be fun to watch. That shit ain't easy. That ball is whizzing back there, kid. I'm telling you, not easy to catch an extra point. They just make it look easy. Got to keep in the game. Move it back if you have to, but don't just get rid of it. I don't know why they would even think about something like that. Getting back to the college game, five-star recruit Ricky Town. It's a great name, by the way. Ricky Town from St. Bonaventure out here in Ventura. Committed to Alabama. And now all of a sudden, because Alabama Lane Kiffin, thank you. Lane Kiffin is now the offensive coordinator. All of a sudden, up and leaves and goes to USC. No blame him. That was the biggest quarterback recruit that they had ever gotten in Alabama in the Nick Saban era. Just up and leaves and goes to USC. Good decision. Why would you leave beautiful Southern California and go to Alabama? Forget that. Fight on. Even though I'm not a big SC fan, I'll take USC over Alabama any day of the week. You know? Last thing before we get in the twit bag. Mike Wallace came out today. Said he should have had 20 more touchdown receptions than he did have. What a thug. Nah, I'm just kidding. That's the Richard Sherman thing. Richard Sherman saying anybody who calls him a thug just kind of, it's really an innuendo. It's kind of a euphemism for calling him the N-word. Which I kind of, yeah, I see his point, but I disagree. I think I believe on this very program, I called Richie Incognito a thug. So there goes that, Richard Sherman. But Mike Wallace comes out and said he should have had 20 more touchdown passes, 20 more touchdown receptions. My point being, all these guys talk shit. And Mike Wallace didn't even have a camera in his face after the game. Just said that's very, you know, under control. All these guys talk mess. What are you going to do? It's part of the game. You're going to throw the microphone in these guys' faces, especially in the heat of the moment. They're going to freaking throw out whatever they say. And then you're like, oh, terrible, terrible. How dare you disrespect the game? John Madden came out and said that too. John Madden said that a few times about disrespecting the game. I don't know. I don't think it's that high and mighty that way. I don't think it's on the pedestal we put it on. I think it's just a game. I think we've put way too much into it. Should I drive all the way out here every Sunday just to talk on a microphone about it? And then my whole damn professional life is coaching the sport. I still think we do too much with it. We had a banquet last weekend. Or this week, Monday. Four and a half hour banquet. Talk about the season. Granted, if you've been listening, we've had a decent season, but for Christ's sake, 4.5 hours about anything. You know, enough is enough. Just a game, people. Why are we so hyped up about it? I would be remiss not to give you some kind of Super Bowl prediction, even though I gave you my Super Bowl prediction about 5 months ago, which we will not talk about. But I tell you, I talked about this a little bit with Slush. I just think when push comes to shove, good defense beats good offense. This will be the fifth Super Bowl since the merger in 1969 where the number one scoring offense plays against the number one scoring defense. In the previous four times, three of the four times the defense won. 1990, Giants versus the Bills, one of the times Bills shit the bet again. 84, Niners, number one defense, Niners versus number one offense, Miami, Niners won. 78, Steelers, number one defense, beating the Cowboys, number one offense. The only time where the number one offense beat the number one defense was the Niners at the number 1-0 versus the number one defense in the Denver Broncos. Back in the Kyle Mecklenburg days, Tom Jackson days, good defense. However, the Niners had the number three defense in the league. So that being my proof positive, I got to say the Seattle wins this game. I think Seattle just they're too fast defensively, especially the weather conditions saying not going to be ideal, although I think that's a little bit overrated. I just think Seattle's defense is too fast. I think they end up winning. I think they end up winning the game. I'll give you a score. What the hell? I say Seattle 21, Denver 17. All right, let's get into the twit bag. Does the NFL even need the Pro Bowl anymore? From Kachia 80. Does the NFL even need the Pro Bowl anymore? I'm a Pro Bowl fan. Like I said, I'm one of the few out there that still enjoys the Pro Bowl. I don't know why there's so much hate against the Pro Bowl. Why, you know, if you like the sport, you like the sport. Yes. There was some serious consideration this year from Goodell. Goodell had some serious consideration this year of getting rid of it. But overwhelmingly, the players are for it. Players like the Pro Bowl. I guess it's a week off in Hawaii. I didn't do my due diligence. I apologize to my listener. I didn't do my due diligence when they had the Pro Bowl draft. I didn't watch it. I was stuck in some wrestling meet somewhere. But the players love it. Players love going to Hawaii and playing. So what the hell? I tell you one good change is why don't they bring the Pro Bowl to L.A.? Why don't they put it in the Rose Bowl? Didn't they watch the national championship game this year? It's glorious. Why can't we play the Pro Bowl in the Rose Bowl? It's another thing they talk about, playing all these exhibition games in London. Why don't they have an exhibition game out here in L.A.? The birthplace of the Super Bowl. But they refuse to do it. Come on, people, rise up. We need a team in Los Angeles. It's evident. But talks have come to a grinding halt. I've heard nothing about it. I don't think it's going to happen yet again. At least not next year. Probably not the year after that. These things take multiple years to actually go through. So to get back in a roundabout way about the Pro Bowl, yes, they need the Pro Bowl. It's closure. It's closure to a season. If you enjoy watching players play, which I do, let the players play. What are you going to do? Moving on. I already addressed this at B. Weather Johnson. NFL gave you carte blanche to change three rules. What are they? I'm not going to be redundant. Already talked about them. Thanks for the question, B. Weather Johnson. And last question, Brian P. Hickey. What's the bigger legacy changer? Peyton Manning winning two Super Bowls with two different teams? Or Pete Carroll winning a championship in both college and NFL? Great question. I thought about that after I read it for a while. There's only two coaches to ever win national championship at the college level and a Super Bowl. And it's kind of, there's kind of an asterisk next to that because it's Jimmy Johnson, won it with Miami, and obviously the Cowboys, and Barry Switzer won it with Oklahoma, and obviously the Cowboys. But it was the same team. The groundwork was laid. So I'm going to have to say Pete Carroll. As much as I've talked some mess about Pete Carroll and the fact that he's a 9/11 conspiracy theorist, which I have no time for, if Pete Carroll can pull it off, because this is Pete Carroll's vision, okay? He took a USC team that was floundering. He took a Seattle Seahawks team that had been floundering, although they did go to the Super Bowl in, what, 06? Give it that. But they were, you know, they were not the crown jewel model franchise of the NFL. if you can go out and win a Super Bowl with this team and have the previous championships, one of them an asterisk as well, that he had with USC, took a team that was fun. I got to say it's got to solidify Pete Carroll as a football Hall of Famer. Now, I know the NFL Hall of Fame is a little different, and that might be a bold statement, but Peyton's already solidified. Unless you're a complete asshole, Peyton Manning is in the top five quarterbacks of all time. You could split hairs and talk about the greatest quarterback of all time. He might be there. And if he wins, he might cement that even more. But I think he's already there. He's already in the pantheon of great quarterbacks. He's going to put Pete Carroll as a chance to shoot himself into legendary status. If you're a fan of the game, you cannot deny what Pete Carroll done if he goes ahead and wins the Super Bowl. You know? Got to give it to him. Even though he's a 9-11 conspiracy theorist, got to give it to him. All right, what else do we got? Couple other things. And you're on this note. NFL finally came out this week and said they're looking to possibly allow medical marijuana for people who have concussions in the NFL. Talk about a Pandora's box. Look, I really don't care about all that. I don't want to get into my feelings on medical marijuana and the legalities of marijuana. But if you're going to say, oh, we will only use marijuana if a guy shows signs of concussion, good luck. I was watching the Brian Gumbel Real Sports with Brian Gumbel, which is 20 years old, by the way. Another thing that makes me feel as old as Deion Sanders' gray beard. 20 years old, they're talking about medical marijuana, and they were saying upwards of 75 to 80% of NFL players use marijuana. I don't know why they're even fighting this battle anymore, especially if they're going to concede that there's a lot of medical research out there that says that helps with things like concussions. Every freaking kid in the NFL, they're going to be claiming concussions after every practice. So screw it, just let them freaking do it. What's it matter at this point anyway? Really, you know, for the children, please. Both the states represented in the Super Bowl, you can buy recreational marijuana. So I don't know why you're even fighting this battle at this point. You can buy it in, you know, in the Bandwagon Bowl or the Stoner Bowl, the Crunchy Bowl between Seattle and Denver. All right, I think I'm sick of talking. There's a couple other things I want to talk about, but I really don't feel like it. All right, I'm not going to be here next Sunday. I'm going to be watching the Super Bowl, obviously, and it bleeds into this, and I want to have some beer, so I'm not going to drive all the way down here to do my podcast next week. So that's that. I'll be back the following Sunday to recap the Super Bowl and give you all the things that the fans out there want, my fan out there is asking for. All right, follow us on Twitter at HodgeOddsLA. Email us at HodgeOddsLA@gmail.com. I'm the coach. Hopefully your Super Bowl party is satisfying. I don't know.